Harper Audio presents The Lost Peace, Leadership in a Time of Horror and Hope, 1945 to 1953, by Robert Dalleck, read by Jonathan Davis. Copyright 2010 by Robert Dalleck, Incorporated. Production copyright 2010 by HarperCollins Publishers.
Introduction. I have no high opinion of human beings. They are always going to fight and do nasty things to each other. George F. Kennan, 1976. At the start of 1945, total war had absorbed the world's energies for almost 10 of the century's first 44 years. Winston Churchill thought of the period between 1914 and 1945 as another 30 years' war. And in 1948, he lamented the fact that after all the exertions and sacrifices of hundreds of millions of people and of the victories of the righteous cause, we have still not found peace or security. It was, in his words, the human tragedy. So much of what happened throughout the 20th century, Churchill believed, was preventable. World War II, he told Franklin Roosevelt, should have been called the Unnecessary War, as many said of the century's first great war, and could also be said of much of the post-1945 international strife. It may well be that a human affinity for struggle and conflict make war, whether among tribes, religions, or nations, inevitable. But heads of state have always had the power to influence events, especially at the end of World War II, when the defeat of Nazism, fascism, and Japanese militarism presented an uncommon opportunity for more rational, humane governance. The rise of new international conflicts, or the failure to secure a stable, more durable peace, can be blamed on a blundering generation of leaders around the world. If this had been a period when American, European, and Asian rulers were notable for their limitations, the lost opportunity might be more understandable. But the sitting and emerging chiefs of state were as able and effective a group of executives as we've seen in any one generation in modern times. This is not to suggest that they were so superior in understanding and judgment to most other preceding and subsequent heads of government that they could do no wrong. They were as vulnerable to human miscalculation as all of us. Still, they were impressively talented politicians, blessed by circumstances favorable to changing international relations for the better. But they didn't, or at least fell well short of what they might have accomplished. Why and how the world's leaders blundered is the focus of this book. At the start of the 20th century, some European thinkers saw the state of war as essential to a nation's survival. Not only did external threats from other countries that coveted territory and resources beyond their borders encourage national militancy between states, but the discipline of a command system also seemed likely to make citizens more productive and the nation more prosperous. And even more than any material benefits generated by a country at war were the intangibles: national pride in disciplined forces performing heroic deeds has had enduring universal appeal. Being too proud to fight has never been a match for courageous warriors ready to give their lives for some larger good. Yet while national leaders have always justified war by invoking the nobility of patriotic sacrifice, they've also made the case for war as a prerequisite for lasting peace. How many in the aggressor nations in 1914 or 1939, however, especially the mass of Germans who rallied to Adolf Hitler's marching orders, would have chosen war if they knew what costs and suffering these conflicts would produce without the promised respite from bloodshed? The horrors of the years between 1914 and 1945 undermined the belief of even the most confident advocates of military action that they could turn the world toward long-term peace. The brutal trench warfare and strains on civilian populations of 1914 through 1918 that destroyed 18 million lives convinced some observers in the 1920s and 30s that total war between advanced industrial societies was too destructive to victors and vanquished alike to let countries ever fight again. As French Premier Georges Clemenceau said after 1918, war is a series of catastrophes that results in a victory. Although a formidable pacifist movement sprang up in Europe and America after 1918, millions of people, especially in the defeated nations, turned the war into a holy crusade. They prided themselves on having fought for a larger good, believing the sacrifice of so much blood and treasure a noble enterprise. This pride, combined with the losers' passion for revenge and the economic collapse of the 1930s, renewed millions of people's faith in the regenerative powers of violence. It allowed Hitler to launch Germany and ultimately all Europe and the world into the Second Great War in a generation. The savagery of the conflict, however, makes it difficult to understand how anyone in Germany, Italy, Japan, and Russia, the aggressor nations, could have justified it as worthy of moral support. The image of the Soviet Union as a victim of aggression should be balanced against its attacks on Finland and Poland. World War II consumed as many as 50 million lives, giving warfare an unprecedented claim on merciless brutality. War had always produced terrible acts of inhumane violence, but never on a scale like that of 1939 to 1945. The war may be recalled not just as an all-out conflict between belligerents, but also as the collapse of civilized behavior. The combined German-Italian air attacks on Republican-controlled cities in the Spanish Civil War of 1936 to 1939, most notably the assault on the Basque town of Guernica, which Pablo Picasso memorialized in his universally recognized painting, the Japanese rape of Nanking in 1937, in which as many as 300,000 Chinese were brutally killed, and the Nazi air raids on London that launched the round of devastating bombardments against innocent civilians, which eventually led to the Allied firebombings of Dresden and Tokyo, and the slaughter of over 100,000 Japanese in the atomic decimations of Hiroshima and Nagasaki. All were calculated acts of destruction in the service of what the belligerents justified as self-defense and deserved punishment of ruthless enemies. The Nazi scorched earth devastation of Russia, which took over 25 million military and civilian lives, aimed to destroy Stalin's communist regime and subjugate what the Nazis considered Russia's subhuman Slavs. An orgy of rape and killing by invading Soviet troops in Germany in 1945 was accepted by most people in the West as understandable, if not justifiable, acts of revenge. By contrast, the massacre of over 20,000 Polish officers by the NKVD, the Soviet secret police, on orders from Stalin and the Politburo, was seen in the West as an act of Soviet ruthlessness to eliminate competitors for the future control of Poland. For the sake of wartime unity, however, London and Washington accepted Soviet assertions of German culpability. The Bataan Death March in the Japanese-American conflict was one of the most infamous episodes in the Pacific War. More than 70,000 already undernourished U.S. and Filipino troops were forced to walk without food and water some 80 miles to prison camps, while being beaten and bayoneted along the way. The Japanese cruelty to surrendering forces, which they viewed as unworthy of honorable treatment, stirred passions for revenge against an enemy seen as undeserving of regard as fellow human beings. Images of Japanese as bloodthirsty fanatics committing atrocities, and metaphors about exterminating vermin, usually yellow rats, abounded in the United States during the war. Japanese troops, who died by the tens of thousands rather than surrender to the Americans in their Pacific Island campaigns, saw capture as too frightening and death as more honorable than giving up. Indoctrinated with propaganda that U.S. Marines had gained admission to the Corps by killing their parents, the Japanese believed that American captors would reciprocate the ferocity that they themselves used against their prisoners. And there was some basis for their fear. Inflamed by stories of Japanese brutality toward captives, eagerness to die for their emperor, and booby traps on surrendering troops, American soldiers killed combatants trying to surrender, mutilated their bodies, and turned body parts into souvenirs. Although Germany's Nazis were regarded with deep animus in the United States during the war, the Germans were not seen as barbaric as the Japanese. Ernie Pyle, America's most famous wartime correspondent, said that in Europe we felt that our enemies, horrible and deadly as they were still people. But out here in the Pacific, I soon gathered that the Japanese were looked upon as something subhuman and repulsive, the way some people feel about cockroaches or mice. Though Germany was a heretic or lapsed sinner from universal standards, these were standards the Japanese never knew. The perception about the Nazis and Germany changed, however, in 1945, with revelations about the Holocaust, the greatest organized slaughter of the entire war. Hitler's campaign of extermination against the Jews. The Nazi obsession with the final solution, Judenrein, ridding Europe of all of its 8.8 million Jews, came close to realization. The destruction of 90% of the Jewish populations of Germany, Austria, Poland, and the Baltic countries, as well as 75% of Holland's, 60% of Belgium's, and 26% of France's Jews, largely achieved Hitler's design. Allied victory in 1945 against so malign a force as Nazism and Japanese militarism was an extraordinary moment. Not simply because the most destructive war in history, which had left many of the world's major cities in rubble, had ended, but also because the mood of cynicism about human behavior made it difficult for even the most optimistic among the victors to imagine a future without war. U.S. General George C. Marshall, Franklin Roosevelt's chief of staff, declared, "If man does find the solution for world peace, it will be the most extraordinary reversal of his record we have ever known." While 81% of Americans in 1945 believed that the United States should join a world organization with power to maintain world peace, only 15% was confident that a United Nations could prevent future wars. And yet leaders among the victors, buoyed by their success in such a deadly struggle, believed that their triumph was bound to bring more tranquil times, if not permanently, at least for a while. War and defense preparations would not disappear entirely, but the appetite for anything resembling the global conflicts of the first half of the century had been sated. The world's leaders saw peace, or an aversion to large-scale combat, as a reflection of what their masses insisted on. "There go the people. I must follow them, for I am their leader," one 19th century French politician declared. Woodrow Wilson similarly remarked that statesmen have to bend to the collective will of their people or be broken. Alexis de Tocqueville made the same point about the world's emerging democracies in the first half of the 19th century, when he wrote, "No man can struggle with advantage against the spirit of his age and country. and however powerful a man may be, it is hard for him to make his contemporaries share feelings and ideas which run counter to the general run of their hopes and desires. Winston Churchill was never willing to be so self-effacing about his or anyone else's leadership of a democratic nation. He decried the part that humbug plays in the social life of great peoples dwelling in a state of democratic freedom. He might have had in mind a February 1945 survey in America asking whether...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.